we're going to get started, everybody. Good evening and welcome. This is the September 26, 2017 meeting of the Finance and Warrant Commission. Welcome to everyone. Westwood Media Center is here, and we grant you permission to take the meeting. Is there anyone else who would like to take the meeting? I see no affirmative responses. So with that, if everyone please stand, we'll do the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you very much. So we have a busy agenda tonight. First on our agenda, we're very lucky to have our superintendent with us, and we'll be hearing from her shortly. And then we will be hearing from all of the warrant article sponsors for the fall town meeting. So with that, we'd like to welcome you, Emily Parks, our superintendent. This isn't very hospitable.
If you're comfortable doing
you. That. You know, I should say that at our June meeting, we talked and we thought it would be a great idea to have you in the fall so that we could welcome you and open the avenues of communication. And we'd love to just hear a bit from you in terms of how it's going and how you're looking at the year ahead.
Great, thank you. So thank you very much for inviting me to be here. I appreciate that. And I do want to introduce or reintroduce Heath Petracca, who is our Director of Business and Finance, really my right-hand man when it comes to things related to this committee. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. I know many people on the committee, but maybe not everybody. So let me give you a quick background that I'm new to the superintendency as of this past July, but not new to the Westwood Public Schools. I've worked in the Westwood Public Schools since 1994, which sounds alarming when I say that out loud. It's a long time. And I've been an administrator in the public schools for the last 17 years. So I'm certainly familiar. I've been through the budget process many times, and I'm quite familiar with the ins and outs of the district. But having said that, I thought it was really important at this moment of transition to a new superintendent to take that opportunity to do a real entry process and kind of get into the balcony myself and calibrate my own perspective on the district with other people's perspective on the district. And so as part of this entry plan that I have, I've been having a lot of conversations over the summer and into the fall with lots of different people. And so I will tell you that I have had the opportunity to meet with lots of folks on the town side of things. I've met several times with Mike Gillette and Dan Dukeman in the context of budget steering with John Hickey and long-range financial planning with Nancy Hyde, and actually had a great meeting with Barb Delisle in her education committee chair role a couple of weeks ago. And I share that with you just to say that those conversations are really centered around understanding what's gone well in terms of budget process between town side and school side, what maybe hasn't gone as well, what we would like to take this opportunity to think about moving forward. And I have found those conversations to be entirely positive and productive and really constructive, and really appreciate the opportunity to have those conversations. So I think that I now have real clarity about the process and timeline, both for sort of the annual budget cycle, but also thinking about long-range financial needs, thinking about capital needs. Clearly, my particular role is to be an advocate for the public schools, and so that's what I will do. But I do that certainly being mindful of the need to be a steward for the town's resources as well. The lens that I come to this.
That's great. It sounds like you're off to a wonderful start, and we're so happy to have you here. Does anyone have questions for Emily?
I'd just like to say that our meeting was great. It was obvious she had read the warrant book. So I now know two people that have actually read the warrant book.
Yes. Entry process is a follow-up.
That is impressive. Well, thank you. Any other questions?
thank you so much for being here, and he was before us often. Thank you very much for coming tonight as well. We look forward to working with you.
Great. Thanks.
Thank you.
Sorry, before you leave, just getting ready to work. We're about the first warrant article we're going to think about today is the Blue Hills article. Do you have a particular point of view on that?
I do have a point of view on that. I mean, you know, Blue Hills is a really good option for some of our students, not a large number. Over the years, the number has varied, typically in single digits. But for some handful of kids, it presents an opportunity that I think is a really important one. And I will say that based on my understanding of their facilities right now, this building project is very much needed. And you know, the amount of money that Westwood contributes is very much tied to how many kids we have going there. And so, if I'm wrong, it's only about $12,000 annually,
yeah,
something like that.
Only makes sense.
Yeah, so it really, I think, is not a very large investment, and the benefit to some students is great. I would certainly say that.
And the alternative is the kids, they could go elsewhere, but then we'd have to pay like out of district tuition.
We would have a responsibility to provide some kind of opportunity, vocational opportunity for kids. Yeah, and this is a good and a cost effective.
So we'll probably get into this with the selectmen, but does the cost that we're paying today per student plus the increase for the increment that we're going to have for whatever it is, 20, 30 years, is that comparable on a per student basis to what we pay?
Yeah, I don't have the exact number in my head, but I can tell you we did look at that at a previous time, and yeah, it was very much in line with the per pupil cost for kids attending school in district.
Good. Great. Thank you.
Great. Thank
All right.
you very much.
Thanks.
Now you can leave.
All right. I already forgot.
Great. Well, with that, I think we'll move right to the Board of Selectmen and Mike Gillette. Welcome. If you want
to. He passed the baton to me, if you don't mind. I'll be looking at him for most answers. But first, thank you for having us. Mrs. Hyde is with us tonight as well. And just wanted to start out by saying this is such an exciting time at Westwood. It's not only welcoming our school superintendent, but in the coming weeks, we hope to finalize our search for a fire truck. We're going to open a police station and a fire station. It just shows such an incredible investment in town. It's just such an exciting time. So I'll just jump right in. The Blue Hills Regional School District, what's interesting about this warrant article is that the town, the Board of Selectmen in the town, could take the option of no action. And by that, it would automatically be approved. We don't think that's the right thing to do. Should have full disclosure and disclose that to the warrant commission and at town meeting's approval. But we do believe it's a worthwhile investment. There was a meeting with the Board of Selectmen, with the Westwood School Committee, with Emily Heath and the executive director of the school. And I don't have the numbers in front of me, but it wasn't out of the realm of what we pay now for people. We have about four students there right now. Correct. We had one enter this year.
We have a 7 degree base average over the period that we're going to be assessed.
So the assessment is based on the number of children, obviously. But the maximum that we would pay for the school improvement project, which is an $85 million project, is $17,500 a year. The renovation is to the existing facilities. It will achieve ADA compliance. It will improve life safety systems. It will replace the HVAC, the electric, the plumbing, the windows, the entries, improve the roof, the telecommunications, climate controls, and lockers. They're really taking these buildings, which are structurally sound, but taking them down their homes and sidewalk. So we hope this meets with your approval. Do you want me to stop after each one for questions?
I think that would be helpful.
Okay. Any questions?
Questions on this one? Yeah.
You said it was 13 to 17,000 per year. How many years?
It is a 30-year bond.
It wouldn't be that amount. It would be stacked out high. That's all bonds.
George. John, question. Does
how many towns are in this district?
14?
Over 10.
I'm getting the exact number.
And my question, what happens if a town, in other words, if we approve it and somebody else doesn't,
well,
what happens?
Yeah. What happens is if one or two towns were to reject it, for instance, what it would do is go to a ballot throughout the district. All the member community would then vote.
Majority rules.
And it would be majority rules over the district. No one community, maybe a community only votes 40, 60 in favor. But if the overall ballot is 50% or greater, it would pass. And then even the communities that are rejecting it, we have to contribute to it.
But on this end, you have to then get every 100% approval to avoid?
To avoid that
outcome.
Yes. We'd have to get 100% of the community saying yes, not no, or not rejecting.
As a follow-up to that, what's the timeline and process in the other towns? Is it going to town?
So there's only a 60-day window from when the Blue Hills Regional School District took their vote. They took their vote on September 19th. So there's a 60-day window to get approval. So they purposely timed it around fall town meetings. So we'll know at our town meeting.
We made a specific bid knowing that we were going to have our town meeting on November 13th, but they're about that we needed. So they actually, I don't know if they did it just for us, but they were originally proposing to take the vote on September 12th, which would just put us on the edge of it. But I don't think they got voted at the county at that point. So they moved their vote to the 19th so that it would.
And so, if a town, Denham, I assume Denham is in here, Braintree?
Yeah, Braintree.
Braintree, okay. If they have their town meeting next week and they vote it down, does that then make our...
No, I would say we should still go forward because we would then be going to the ballot process. I think it would be important to get our town on record as a support. I would back out.
John, what's our percentage of the share of the expense, and what's the, you know, the overall enrollment of Blue Hills Boat?
I
do. Do you have it?
Yeah, there's about 900 kids, so we're less than 1%.
Yeah.
The other thing that is worth noting is that it's $85,000. They've chosen to do $85 million. Sorry, they've chosen to do a renovation project. Other regional school districts have decided to full construction projects, replacing the schools. There's a certain number, I can't remember exactly what it is, that the state, I think it's $350 a square foot, the state will reimburse you that. And so in those school districts that they're going up to construction costs are way above that. So they're getting about the reimbursement that they get from the state amounts to about a quarter or less of what the outlay is by the district. In this case, it's 51%. It's as high as it can be. They're getting $43 million from the state and $42 million from the communities in the district. And they purposely budgeted it that way so it would be a 50-50 split.
Just a quick one. I assume the school will be operating during this renovation?
They are. Yeah, that was one of the questions we talked about. Messages, they are really going down. But from what we've heard at that meeting and other meetings involved with Westwood schools, they've been now really compartmentalized construction and allowed the school to operate.
How long of the project do they expect it to be?
A year and a half.
That was mine, but I guess I had a follow-up. Are there any other expected costs, or is this
everything? This would be the assessment.
They said that they could serve a week.
And again, our Westwood enrollment, the average is 7.5. We'll look back here in 4 years. We only have like 1 goal this year. The numbers are actually going down for us. So our assessment goes down with it, proportionally. If anything, I'm a lot.
So that was going to be my question. Will the assessment go up if our enrollment goes up?
It does.
So the 13,000 to 17,000 per year will change? should our enrollment change?
The 17.5 is based on if we were to hit that 7.5 again, which is highly unlikely. The numbers over the past 3 years have gone down 1 per year, so it's highly unlikely.
Are we just not voting on the money? Is it future participation as well with Blue Hills?
That's not the vote.
No, right.
I know,
no.
And that's, are we jeopardizing our ability to send students there if we vote this down?
No, this is like any other capital improvement project. Okay. If this goes away, our enrollment is statutory, right, our participation. So that there's nothing to do with that. I think what would begin to happen, what we hear from them is, I think they would start to worry about accreditation. You know, they're in, what is that, some dire straits, some of the capital needs they have. So there would be other issues. We've all recognized we do have an obligation to provide alternatives to the high school. We're fortunate that we have a very small population that takes advantage of that, but it's in our best interest to just go forward.
So this is a bond that they're gonna raise. We're not actually named on the bond. It has nothing to do with our credit rating.
Nope.
Or whatever.
Right, Dan, you're okay?
Well, in our financial statements, anything that we're a part of, it would show our portion of that assessment,
right,
in
right.
Our financial statements.
But if they don't pay the bond, that doesn't reflect
nope.
on us so long as we're paying our share.
If they don't pay the bond.
If they don't pay the bond.
We're
not paying
more
than our share. Yeah. I just want to follow up a question about being statutorily obligated to participate. So I don't know, do you have any idea, ballpark, what our annual Blue Hills contribution is in addition to this?
It's about $40,000 a year.
$40,000. So in theory, if we took that $40,000, if we had $55,000, so let's put that to, you know, shop. Teacher here, could we do that, or are we still obligated to participate in Blue Hills?
I don't know that we want to go down the path. So
I'm not saying we should. Yeah, I'm just wondering. I'm asking what you meant by statutory.
No, the question was, if the capital project doesn't go forward,
yeah.
are we then out of the Blue Hills Regional School District?
Yeah.
The answer is no. Our connection to Blue Hills Regional School District is a statutory relationship. It has nothing to do with this capital project. That was. Does that make sense? We could not send a student for 10 years.
Yeah. But we are by law required to contribute.
We have to
based on our proportion. We don't send someone, we don't pay.
We have to provide that source, that sort of opportunity. So you could, but I can guarantee you the out-of-district tuition and our transportation expenses. I'm not sure, because I know that although we have a very small number, our per student cost is higher than, say, a Brockton, where a third of the students there are Brockton students. Their per student cost, they were explained to me, there is substantially lower. So you get kind of a discount for, we're far from that level of discount. You do get a discount. I'm not sure if we go down to zero. We don't have students. There might be some sort of just holding fee.
That's correct, because they have like admin costs and whatever. And the state participates in that formula of assessments, and communities are kind of assessed on like a state education formula, and we are charged a bit higher for students than other communities.
Other questions from the I think we're good on that one.
Okay. Move on to Hay Street Sidewalk Design Funding. So this article is intended to provide funding to the DPW to complete a full design for sidewalks along Hay Street, submit the project to the state's Complete Streets program. The scope of this work would include application of the state for funding, traffic data collection, public meetings, obviously, and checkpoints at 25, 75, and 100% of the design levels. The town is seeking $225,000 to fund the design of the sidewalk. My memory serves me right, it was a 2016 town meeting when this design of these sidewalks became quite an issue. So Mike Gillette has had some preliminary discussions with those who feel passionate, and we feel confident we can get to a design that works for everybody.
Do you have any bit more on that?
Well, just that we had a neighborhood meeting, had a neighborhood discussion about putting a sidewalk on one side of the street or the other. We've got to shift back and forth. One point where we are, and then later to end in school. The neighborhood, you know, had mixed feelings about it, but they were increasingly families with children that want to have a safe place to walk on that street. And so there was a lot of discussion of that at the last meeting. There was a general feeling that we had made the appropriate or the right decision on each side of the road to locate it. There were concerns about stone walls. There were concerns about trees that might need to be eliminated. So it's, you know, they understood that it's going to take a full design to be able to determine what, if anything, needs to be done. There was a promise being made that we would relocate the existing stone walls back to allow space for the sidewalk to go in. You know, the neighborhoods are not completely sold. But they were, by the end of the meeting at least, receptive to the discussion and receptive to the feeling of the families that were there that wanted to have a safe place for their children and their spouses and themselves to walk by each other.
There's actually quite a few neighborhoods, right, that
yes.
impacts all the way down Gay, and of course the people, you know, at the bottom. That would be the only way to get to the top.
And there are two schools at either end,
right.
Which if you're encouraging walkers to go to school, these sidewalks are helpful for that purpose.
Questions from FinCom?
Yeah. How do we get the figure of 225? Where does that estimate
we,
come from?
We have a, we've had a consultant. What we have is a base survey right now. So we're surveying the entire area, and we have a design engineer, and they gave us the estimate.
So we don't bid the design of it,
I guess.
Just the consultant.
We have a selected firm. I couldn't tell you how we selected that firm. They are the ones, it's the same firm that did, if you're familiar with, the Forbes Road, Downey Street sidewalk that got put in under the state program, Safe Routes to School. It's the same firm that did that project for us. They're very familiar with state aid projects. They're very good at assisting communities in achieving funding from state sources.
So when we voted on this 2 years ago, it was part of the 109 sidewalk construction, and there was a number associated with the 109 and Gay Street sidewalk design. What portion of that went to 109 versus Gay Street? Because I remember Todd got up at town meeting and said, we just want the sidewalk at 109. So are we gonna, is this going to then be a problem then? Now we're coming back and saying, right now we need an additional $225,000 for the Gay Street design, when it sort of looks like we already appropriated that money 2 years ago?
We didn't appropriate the money for the Gay Street design, but we appropriated most of the money for, as you said, for the Route 109 construction project. So it was design and construction. And we appropriated a small sum of money, and I can't remember exactly. I want to say the vicinity of $50,000. That money was for the survey work that we needed to do. That's all we were doing. Now, with the survey, we were able to prepare what I call conceptual plans for where a sidewalk would be located and how it would look. But now we need to take the survey data in those conceptual plans, put them together, and additional information would have to be gathered in the field so we can design the actual construction project for the sidewalk. So that's what this 225, so it's in addition to the survey.
What's your level of buy-in that you want to see from the neighborhood before you go to the next level?
It's not going to be consensus.
I
don't know how to speak. I don't know how to say that. I think that the board's going to have to, you know, listen to what the neighborhood is saying, and we got to hold another public hearing. We promise to come back in in the fall, looking at solar, to have another discussion about this.
When the design is done, so it's.
No, we're gonna come back even before that.
In part of our, the issue really centers around conservation space. And there's a sense from some folks that if you put a sidewalk in front of the conservation space, you in fact soil the conservation space, destroy the aesthetics. So, the, you know, the opposite of that is all these families with young children saying, we're like campers in our neighborhood, we need to drive just to go to Starbucks. So, what they've worked on, and what we think we can get to with the design, is a way to answer both problems. And it's probably not ideal if we were laying out a tunnel for the first time. We would just put one straight length of sidewalk down the side of the road. This is gonna require a crossing point or two, but we can, to the best that we can, say to people, we're doing on the conservation space, and we hear you trying to have a walk in the town. So we are trying to play a little bit of King Solomon. So at some point, we're gonna have to say to both sides, we heard you both, and we got this as far as we could.
Yeah. Will a crossing point or two require crossing guards during school hours?
They already do. There's at least one.
There's one at Hanlon Street.
There's one at Pine Lane.
In the Pine Lane.
Two.
So will you require two?
There's one in front of the Hanlon, there's one in Pine Lane.
Right. Okay. So it's already requiring.
Right, but will there be two additional?
It would depend on whether or not there are school children that are walking in as a crossing point. If there's a crossing point on Gay Street that and children are walking to school, I'm pretty sure it would require a crossing guard. That's a pretty heavily traveled, quickly traveled roadway. And so I think, you know, currently we only need to do the two near the Hanlon School, but you know, I can't even remember where the crossing point is. And then necessarily have to have school children walking public roads to get from school.
Chris?
Is the safe walk to school separate from the complete street program?
Yes, they're two different programs, two different
so I see
federal
this,
programs.
We're applying for the project funding to complete streets. We can't split it?
No, we possibly could. No, it's Complete Streets is where we've gotten funding thus far for some of these sidewalks, but we also were successful. I think there's a little less money available at present for the Safe Routes to School, and being a community that already got Safe Routes to School funding, you know, like farther down the road. Yeah. But the Complete Streets, and we're one of the leading communities, we've successfully gotten grants out of that program 2 years ago.
I think people are familiar with where the crosswalks are on Gay Street at the bottom near the Hanlon, and you know, are not accustomed to people crossing anywhere else, really, on what's a pretty quickly traveled road. So would there be some safety focus in this design in terms of analyzing the traffic patterns and
yes.
How that might work?
Yes, I can assure you. I can remember from the public hearing, there were some issues around where Milk Street intersects, and some discussion about the traffic movement that occurs there and in crossing at that location. So yeah, there are issues along the way that came up in the public hearing that certainly will be part of the design. That's part of it. It will be done in the next phase. We haven't got the answers yet.
I know it's really early in the process, but how much do you think we'd be able to get for a grant? We probably would get the whole thing funded, so do we have any sort of estimate?
I think that this might be a multi-year project, but at present, grants are going. We got the highest grant possible in the first round. I think it was $400,000. The last round we got just under two. I think $400,000 is what we can get. This project is about a million.
So we might be doing it over the course of
years. We might be doing multiple grant submissions, doing a piecemeal, going for a Safe Routes to School grant, or there are always new grant programs, so once you get this designed, now you're eligible for doing things. We've done the same thing with road projects. We've designed them, and then a state comes up with a grant program, we've got a design. So you've got an advantage if you've got a design in your pocket that you can, well, our sewer system, if you go back in history long enough, our sewer system, we're 99% sewered. And what happened back in the old days is they had projects ready to go every time a grant came up, or the end of a year came and they hadn't spent all the money out of the grant program that they had. We had projects this year, and we were very successful.
Any other questions on Gay Street?
Okay, the next warrant article involves the Arc of South Norfolk down on Flatwood Tree Street. The executive director came and spoke with us. This involves the perimeter of their property. They want to put a sidewalk all the way around. And what that will allow is some of the wheelchair bound and other folks the ability to access some raised beds that are about the Mercer property. So this has been approved by the Sewer Commission, the Director of Public Works. We were okay with it. We were very clear. Any easement, we will allow you to build over it. You assume all of the risk. Should we ever need to access our sewer line, we will. So we don't have a problem supporting it. We ask for your support as well. Any questions?
Questions? Don't see any on that.
Okay. The next one is a street acceptance of Thompson Avenue, the Westview Estates subdivision. It's intended to seek town meeting's approval to bring Thompson Avenue in as a public way. The developers are currently finalizing all the necessary requirements with the trees. We'll have to pass a drainage inspection, and that meets all of our standards. The selectmen will hold a public hearing on this matter on Monday, October 16th. The planning board will also hold a public review session. This is somewhat pro forma, so large they meet all of our standards.
In curiosity, where is Westview Estates?
Westview Estates is off.
Yes, yeah. Off of Winter Street.
Similarly, Hedgerow Lane, this is a right-of-way abandonment. This article is intended to authorize the selectmen to eliminate the existing cul-de-sac right-of-way. The parties are attempting to reach an agreement for reapportioning their land to achieve the appropriate amount of frontage on the new lane. If the parties manage to agree, the developer will request the abandonment of the old right-of-way so that the three homes all have frontage on the new road. And I will quickly turn to Nora to interpret that.
So the planning board approved a subdivision, Westwood Estates, that has 10 new homes and reorients Hedgerow Lane so that it goes through and connects to Lyons Drive. The front portion of it, where Hedgerow meets Canton Street, it's shifted to one side, and the plans that the planning board approved called for the old right-of-way that ends in the cul-de-sac, the pavement to be removed and grassed over, or landscaped and driveways extended. There are three houses that were affected by that, and the owners of those three homes decided after that subdivision was approved, when we came to the selectmen, to request that selectmen approve the removal of the pavement and the landscaping. They decided they did not want that. So now they've come back to the planning board, and we encourage them to work with the developer to actually abandon that old road so that their driveways, their properties, will come right up to the new road. That's just a difference of who owns which piece of land, whether they have driveways that go across town land to a town right of way, or if they go right from their land to the town right of way. The reason it's a little bit complicated is that if it was just a straight abandonment, one or two of those homes would not have the sufficient frontage that's required to make it conforming lot. So in order to allow this to happen, the town has to abandon the road, but the parties, the developer and the three property owners, have to have side agreements ready beforehand that once they receive their portion of the abandoned road, they will then swap out portions of the land so that everyone ends up with the proper amount of frontage. So it's rather complicated. The surveyors are still working on the plan, and hopeful that we'll make it in time for your hearing on the 17th, but we don't have the final plan or those agreements from the neighbors yet.
It looks, maybe I should have brought the plan, but it looks very funny, the way that the land lines up being in front of these homes. So it's almost in an essence as though these people may not want these enormous front yards.
if they don't have those agreements that by our voting, then we're just not gonna be in a position.
Then it will not go forward, and that stalls the subdivision.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you.
Okay, the next one involves town hall and office space overall. This article is intended to serve as a placeholder for the municipal facilities task force as it goes through the analysis of the space needs of the municipal departments. The determination is made that the town can make a modest modification of municipal space in town hall and or other buildings to move the offices out of the basement. Funds will be sought for this interim measure. So part of this involves the opening of the police station and the selectmen moving into some space in the police station, so that ideally we can take employees who are in the basement of town hall now out of the basement. It's just not ideal. It's not working. It's just, it's not tenable to do it for the long haul. So that is the,
It's an interim plan as to what needs to be done with town hall long term. So it will allow us to do some space planning for free up the selectmen's meeting room. And we need the resources to plan for that. So it'll be an interim step leading maybe somewhere down the road to a more complete rehabilitation of town hall.
What is the timeline? So this is a placeholder.
Right.
What's your timeline on this?
Well, the task force meeting this week, and the consultants are going to give us their thoughts at that meeting. They've interviewed all the departments, they've reviewed the buildings and the facilities, and they're going to be giving us their thoughts this week. So we're hoping that we'll have some sort of number to present with some sort of concept as how those would be, that the monies would be spent, you know, at the public hearing.
And just so that our new members are aware, George and Tom serve as representatives on the Municipal Facilities Task Force, so they'll be keeping track of this as well. Thank you, that's good to know. Any other questions for now?
Yeah, Julie. What are the implications for Carvery Street? It says and or Carvery Street.
I think what Mike's point is that it was part of the overall study.
Oh, okay.
Is there a better utilization of some of that space? And similarly, the next warrant article is also a placeholder. We don't have an amount of money, but we may, based on what we get back from the consultant, seek the appropriation of funds to advance the process to design conceptual plans for the renovation of various municipal office spaces. And when we talk about the main fire station on 109, we talked about a rehab on a new construct. The senior center desperately needs some work. Where can we utilize some money for recreation and family services offices? The intent is to continue to develop and prioritize a master plan for the municipal facilities overall.
And John, can I ask how, and Nancy, maybe you can help on this too. As you know, when we have talked in recent years about capital spending, we like to do it in the context of the long-range plan for the town. So, can you talk maybe a little bit about how, just conceptually, the work of the task force is working with the work that's being done by the Long Range Planning Committee? How do those two fit together?
Yeah, so Long Range Planning has always been looking at our capital list, and this is almost an outgrowth of two things. What Long Range Planning has said on its list and the work that the public safety facilities task force do. With the public safety facilities, we knew with the three buildings we had, main fire, substation, and police station, each one had issues we had to deal with. Two buildings that were completely inadequate, and another building that needed some rehabilitation, the main fire station. And we prioritized the fire substation because of the need for additional equipment with growth in the town, particularly at University Avenue. And we knew we needed a larger police station some of you may recall, we looked at actually seeing if we could combine them. That didn't happen. We're building two new. And then we're left with the main fire station out of that program. And correctly so, we didn't want to just take that one building and not look at it in the context of what's going on more broadly with the municipal buildings. We've had Town Hall on the list. We've had the Council on Aging, not only for repair, but potential expansion. We have concerns with the conditions of the Islington Community Center. We have the Obed Baker House that we have something we need, you know, haven't done with over a decade, a vacant building, Carvey Street. So we're looking at all the facilities and we're saying, how are we going to do this? And how do we take what are these facility issues in long-range planning, but look at them comprehensively? So there's, I don't know, it's a Venn diagram. There's going to be a little bit of overlap, but we're going to be doing facilities work in the Municipal Facilities Task Force, and long-range planning will have a piece, you know, we'll report into them, and then they'll continue to do forecasting of capital budgets for 5 years overall, forecasting of operating budgets overall. So I would say they aren't completely separated, and yet they aren't the same thing. And in this construction or the formation of this Municipal Facilities Task Force, we've included the schools. So Emily's part of that, and Carol Lewis and Tony Mullen are also participants. Here's an example of why it's important. As the schools think long-term about what they're going to do with their elementary schools, if by chance they were, for instance, to move out of the Downey School, the process is that the Downey School becomes the responsibility of the town. What would we do with it? So as we're thinking about things, we want to hear from them how decisions they make may impact decisions we make on municipal facilities. So we're really trying to bring all relevant parties together in the discussion.
Question. It might be a question for you, Pam. The process of this, let's say that you pull out X amount of dollars to move the tax department up to the selectman's room. That would be presumably spent in 2018 and get in fiscal 2018 from free cash. Is that how you do it? Is that what this warrant would ask for?
Well, we
right
haven't
to do?
Kind of looked at how we would fund any of these yet. There's no, you know, I haven't been given kind of a range of dollars yet.
But this isn't, so, I mean, this is coming fall town meeting, so this is not part of the budgeting process. This is talking about getting authorization to spend.
Well, we'll have to fund it at the fall town meeting, yeah.
Yeah. And can you tell us where, do we have free cash certified yet for the end of last year?
We do. We just presented that at the selectmen's meeting last night, so we'll be sending that out. Really, our net free cash amount is certified at about the same amount as last year, about 0.3 million. $5.3 million. Just about the same as last year. That's our net. We're certified at 5.9, and there's one item that explains, you know, say coming up. But 5.3, we would use that to vote similar ways that we have in the current year. We vote 1.7 million for our base school and municipal capital ongoing articles. We vote 100,000 for the transfer to stabilization fund. We vote 500,000 for that to reduce the tax rate. We've had that article for the last couple of years. And then that leaves us a little bit of a delta. We're not supposed to use all of that money. Our financial policy is saying we should have some money still remaining there. We should have about 2.9 million. We've not reached that every year. We go a little further in our allocation, but it gives us some additional money to use for extra capital, other financial warrant articles that come up. So you remember last year, one of the extra capital we did was the school IT network project for about 400,000. So we're really right in line with where we've been the last couple of years as far as having a base amount to do capital and the stabilization and the free cash, the tax rate allocation, and then some additional funds to do additional capital on the warrant articles.
Are there questions for me?
All right, the next two are our accounting housekeeping articles, and some of this has to do with the Commonwealth Modernization Act and how we budget money. And the first has to do with establishing an account for the meals and hotel tax, the local option that we opted into first in 2014.
the meals tax in 2016 for the hotel. This article will allow us to comply with the updated regulations from the Department of Revenue. It does not change any of the original intent. And when we talked about the meals and hotel tax money, right now, we don't have it designated for a specific purpose. And at some point, that's a policy decision that we're going to make as a town. But this is really, as I said, a housekeeping matter. It's not the allocation or expense of any money.
Yes, it's just the housekeeping of how we keep this essentially on our accounting books. So 2014, town meeting voted to accept the local option meals tax, put it into a restricted account, have all the meals tax that came in go into that account, and then require town meeting vote to utilize that money. The Department of Revenue has advised that we need to actually vote that just in a little bit different manner. We need to set it up as one of these special purpose accounts under Chapter 45B. But when we do that vote at town meeting, it's the same thing. Sets up a separate account, all the money coming in goes into that account, requires town meeting vote to utilize that money. So it doesn't change the intent at all as to what town meeting did, but Department of Revenue is asking that we re-vote it in this manner.
So it doesn't change it functionally at all?
Not at all.
It doesn't change the standard of the vote that has to get the money taken on mail?
Well, actually now it's, it raises the threshold. A special purpose account is similar to how we have that capital stabilization funds. That requires a two-thirds vote to use. And as John mentioned, the Municipal Modernization Act that the state did in 2016, they really put in all kinds of kind of accounting and financial cleanup to help municipalities. They want to see a little bit more consistency to towns, help things run a little bit more efficiently. So there's just some different things as we go along that they're going to ask us, things we already have in place, to just set up under something kind of newer that they have established. So to set this up, they're requiring us to set this up differently than how we currently have it. But it doesn't change at all the intent of that original town meeting vote, how that money's held.
What's our approximate annual revenues from the meal tax?
So on an annual basis, it's been about $320,000. So we've had it in place, as of June 30th, I think we had about $680,000.
That was the balance in the account?
That's the balance in the account. And when we looked at it as an annual basis, it seems to be settling out at about $80,000 a quarter. And you'll recall when the town first adopted it, we said we need to wait and see before we use it, what it might look like on an annual basis. It still can fluctuate going forward, but it seems to be settling in around that.
Pam, I'm not familiar with the Municipal Modernization Act of 2016. So is that a mandate to the towns that they do this, or what is the language?
So the Modernization Act is when Governor Baker came into office. They went out and did an outreach to communities and really said, what are all the kind of nitty-gritty things on the books that hinder you, from a financial perspective mostly. What better things can we put in place or clean up? And they came up with this very comprehensive package that was voted in that kind of just updated old laws and regulations in lots of different areas. In there was a few additional tools of how towns could do things, certain things with money. Some of it was kind of, almost like catching up to things that had come along. One of the example of that is the kind of cable access money. All communities now kind of have cable access. We get some money on the cable bills to have Westcat and things like that every town has. So the DOR has now come out in that package and standardized, here's how you need to have some of those things set up. So that kind of happened. They're not mandating that we have to do this, but we're in a nutshell not allowed to have the meals tax account in the format that we currently have it. So if we don't vote something new, it'll be closed out to free cash. So right now that $680,000 is sitting segregated as town meeting voted it. If we don't take some action, it will be closed out in the next time we have free cash certified.
Any other questions?
Okay, and the next one again is an accounting housekeeping matter, but this has been spoken about over the years. And it's to establish a reserve account for special education funding. and this again was part of the Modernization Act, was one of the issues that municipalities identified because of the wide fluctuations in cost that you experience with this type of account. So with the Finance Commission's approval and town meeting's approval, existing funds would be set into this account for this year. Going forward, it would be a standalone account, which again, we think would be more helpful in managing the fluctuations in the cost.
So if town meeting accepts this, it'll set up a special education reserve account, which allows communities to set aside funds to deal with the fluctuation and unanticipated spikes in special education costs. It does take the school committee vote and a town meeting vote for this to get in place. So we have worked with the school committee, and they're voting in an upcoming meeting. And then to utilize the funds from that on an ongoing basis, it requires a school committee and board of selectmen vote. It does not go back to town meeting kind of to actually use the funds once they're in place. But this was a specific new tool, as John said, that came out of that Municipal Modernization Act, because lots of communities struggle with the difficulty in the budget process and the fluctuating costs. This is one where we, as with other communities, had, in a sense, an account on the books that tried to handle some of the special education costs. School districts receive some Medicaid reimbursement for some of the special education costs they provide, and communities can take in that Medicaid money, and we had it set up in a revolving account. Department of Revenue has said this is the system that you need to have in place if you want to set aside and reserve some accounts for special education. So we did have an account set up, and cumulative from what we had in that account, we had about $570,000. That was on our books as of June 30th, that the Department of Revenue did require us to close out and kind of got rolled into our free cash certification. So that's the number I said in the beginning. Our official free cash certification was 5.9 million, but it contained this closeout of about 570,000 of kind of school, Medicaid, special education funding. So we would, at town meeting, establish this account, and then with that vote of free cash, put that money that we already had and we're using for this purpose into this account. So again, we've talked through that with the schools, and they're supportive of that. And again, it's really just now, you know, how the Department of Revenue would like to see communities set aside funds and use funds for special education reserve.
And I'm sorry, what is the process with the school committee? When is that happening?
They're going to vote on their October 11th meeting.
Great.
In the budget, I think it was previous year, not this past year, the town had kind of said to the schools, yeah, we'll provide some money to cover some extra costs on them. But it was kind of a whole yes. number, but, you know, we didn't necessarily have to pay it. They didn't have those expenses. So that money was never real money. I mean, there was no account that was set up for that. I know we've talked about setting
up. Yeah, we had, I think it was this May, maybe the
I think it was
previous May, where the schools had, we set aside $100,000 in like an Article 2, one of the supplemental budget articles, because the school said, we don't know if we're going to have this cost in the budget, we might. And so as part of the process, we all set aside some money in case it that cost gained, it did not. But this is the kind of account that would do just that.
So that $100,000 just expired at the end of the year.
That one didn't. It's still there.
Okay.
And that is something.
So that would be something else that would go into
yes.
that.
Yes. So the state's just trying to streamline and say, we understand that people need to, you know, a reserve's a great idea to have to help you with these fluctuating costs. This is how we want you to set it up. Not kind of the little articles or not a revolving account. You need to set it up in this process if you want to do that. So again, it's kind of a new tool. We didn't, you know, not do it. It wasn't available before. Now it's available, and this is how we should be doing the accounting for it.
Are you or the school committee going to set up some sort of criteria as to when it's appropriate to take that money? You know, is it going to be any increase? It's going to be tied to particular out-of-district costs or something, or is it just going to end up being kind of a regular line item in the budget?
Yeah, the language with the establishment of the account kind of indicates what is eligible for those expenses. so we can get you the detail of what that is. It's really felt like those years where there's a spike or an unanticipated cost during the year.
Okay.
Budget set and there's a
cost to move it up.
I think it would be helpful if we could see that language.
Mm-hmm.
That would be great. Thank you. Any other questions on this article?
And so we do have three miscellaneous placeholders, obviously. Should we seek to take advantage of that and get your information as soon as possible? If you don't know, sorry. Yeah, I was going to just introduce that. There are members of the planning board with us as well tonight. We have a joint warrant article related to limiting the number of residential dwelling units in the flexible, multiple-use overlay districts. And part of the driver of this warrant article...
John, I'm sorry. Could I interrupt you just for a second?
Yeah.
Just going back to the placeholders. I assume if... we will know in advance of our October 17th hearing if there's anything coming.
Correct. As I sit here tonight, I don't know if there is one.
Okay.
There was a chance that there was an RFP the town was putting out. We were hoping to get part of town meeting this fall. That's not going to happen. So that was the only one that I was aware of.
There was one other one that it doesn't look like it's going to happen.
Right. I think we've run out of time. But obviously, we would let you know well in advance.
Okay, great. Thank you. Sorry.
But my suspicion is that I'm not correct. I'm sorry.
No,
I
apologize.
Too fast. No, that's okay. So as I was saying, this has to do with the fact that as we look at the development along Washington Street and 109, there was a sense that residents would like to know with some clarity, if we approve this project, how many more residences are allowed. And so there was an effort to really kind of up with a quantifiable amount to set a cap around that amount. And we have seen this in other municipalities. It does seem to alleviate some concerns that folks have as we develop these parcels. And I'm going to turn it over to the planning board. I don't know if you guys want to make any comments.
Sure, yes. I'm
Gabby
McCabe, the town planner. With me tonight is planning board chairman Trevor Lovenson and vice chair Dave Atkins. The planning board talked about this article at their last meeting and agreed to co-sponsor this with the Board of Selectmen. The planning board has supported this article to help, as John said, alleviate the concerns and to set a clear maximum of the residential dwellings that could be allowed in the High Street and Washington Street overlay districts. The planning board approved their first special permit for residential in 2016, and since that time the planning board and town meeting has heard concerns about how many units could be developed. We have the bylaw currently regulates it by a maximum of floor area of 50% to your project size, but we are adding this maximum, and right now we proposed it at 90 in the Washington Street, 90 unit residential units in the High Street, so 90 in each district.
That would, by the way, include anything that's already been approved, like Culver School on High Street or 321 Washington Street. So that's not an increment over the current number, but the gross number for those that are already in it. And it doesn't, this article would not take away the special permit authority that still rests with the planning board. There's still discretion with the planning board not to approve projects. So really all we're saying is there was a natural cap believed to exist, but it was never defined, and so we're going to work together to formally present a ceiling on it. Abby referred to what's been discussed so far, 90 is the cap, but there's a little more discussion to take place.
And Abby, just for the sake of folks perhaps watching this later, could you just describe generally the boundaries of the Washington Street areas? Identify which is 6, which is 7, and also High Street and Washington, just the rough boundaries.
So FMUD 6, that's the Washington Street. That's, you have a map in front of you. So it's from really the municipal parking lot in the CVS building, down, straight down on the west side, down to the optometrist, and then down to really the end of the street, past where the property connects to the railroad tracks at the intersection of Clappertree and Everett Street. So that's the Washington Street overlay district, and then on High Street, it's a total of 13 parcels. That's from the office building on High Street, Camilla's property up to the bank, yes, Denham Savings Bank, and then it includes the Colburn School down to the Starbucks, the Starbucks and the gas station. Right along the intersection of High Street and Parker Street.
Great, thank you. Questions? Peter?
Can you give us a sense of how you came up with the 90 district?
So I can explain that. We, at recent Islington Center Task Force meetings, we heard a lot of concern where people were assuming that both of these districts could see 500, 600, 700 residential units under the bylaw. And while we responded that we did not see how that was possible, we felt that there was a need to give a little bit more clarity. So I had done an investigation where I looked at, first look at Washington Street, the most beneficial combination of all parcels that were contiguous, the most extensive development that could take place on the property, the maximum floor area, the minimum landscaping, best organization of parking spaces and circulation. I looked at each parcel like that and determined that I could find a way to fit in 149 units in the Washington Street District. And looking at the High Street District, I did the same thing, and I came up with 119 units. And I believe those numbers are well overinflated because the Planning Board special permit has many criteria, including buffer zones, setbacks in some cases, and what's called a public amenity that the board can require as part of a special permit, all of which require land. In addition, it's only 50% residential and 50% commercial, depending on what the type of commercial was. I did my calculations using the least parking intensive commercial and the least parking intensive residential, one bedroom units and retail. So what that would do is it would give you the fewest number of parking spaces you had to accommodate on the property, which would give you the most building area you could come up with. So, you know, putting everything in favor of building the biggest buildings with the most number of apartments, those are the numbers I came up with, 149 for Washington Street and 119 for High Street. I don't believe that the Planning Board would ever see proposals that were that large. I don't believe that for developers it would be worth their while to combine properties in that lane. I don't think the Planning Board would waive all landscaping and buffer zones and allow the largest possible buildings and not require any public amenities. So I think that there's room for a reduction of those numbers, and I really just looked at it and thought what I thought might be reasonable. I looked at Washington Street and saw that there are 12 units already there, and thought about how many more units could reasonably go in there, and I thought 90 was a large enough number to accommodate any future demand for units there, and a low enough number to give people a way to visualize what that gap would be. And in that way would not be taking away too much from the property owners, too much of the rights that they already have under the existing zoning. I did the same thing on High Street. High Street was a little bit harder to combine the parcels, just due to the, not so much to combine them, but to figure out how they would be developed more to more because of the topography of some of the parcels and the split zoning of some of the parcels. If you look at, say, the Gulf Station and the Mobile Station on High Street, they have commercial zoning in the front and they have residential zoning in the back. And I wanted to look at it from the perspective of if there was a zone change to make the whole property part of the overlay district, would they be able to get some more? So I tried to inflate the numbers as much as I could and come back down to what I thought was a reasonable number. But it's not a hard and fast science. You could you could plan any one parcel or any combination of parcels a number of different ways. An engineer could come up with all sorts of different plans, and I don't have the expertise, the time, or the skill to prepare those plans. So it's a little bit more than a back of the envelope calculation, but I think it's well in excess of what we would be likely to see in those districts.
How many units on High Street already?
There are 6 units. They're in the Colburn School, and they were developed under, they predated the FMUOD districts. They were developed under something called an upper story residential overlay district. But those units are within the land area that's calculated for the FMUOD, and we would craft the language to make sure that those units are counted towards the maximum count.
Does this 90 take into consideration the ones on High Street that were just, not High Street, Washington Street, that are just erected and in planning stages, or is it 90 above those?
No, it's 90 in total. So there are 12 existing units there, and it would include those 12 units, and it would include any other units that have been discussed, whether or not they're applied for. So the 90 would be the cap for any residential construction in that area. It could never exceed 90.
So I guess I have 2 questions. One, why isn't 90 in the article itself? Why don't we explicitly say we're capping to 90 units?
It is in the article. It might not be in the article explicitly there, but it's in the article.
Yeah, this was just supposed to be a preview. I mean, we're on technical language now.
Oh, okay.
So all the zoning articles, that article is jointly sponsored, and the ones Abby will tell you about that the planning board is sponsoring, they've all been advertised and posted for a public hearing that's occurring next Tuesday night. So okay. The language is specified, and it does say 90. Now, that's subject to a public hearing. All zoning articles require a public hearing before the planning board, and the purpose of that public hearing is to hear commentary from citizens, and there's an opportunity for the planning board, or in the case of this article, for the selectmen and the planning board to reconsider how they word the articles.
Can I ask a second question? I'm sorry, I haven't read it. Do we have to explicitly define what a unit is if we're using unit as a measure?
It's already, I believe it's already defined in the zone.
What is that unit for? Do we know what is the definition?
What's the definition of dwelling unit? I don't have it.
Is it by square foot or is it?
No. Dwelling unit is not. It's a measure of housing that's occupied by a single household. That's essentially how you describe it. I don't know if those are the exact words, but a residential unit, whether it's a 1-bedroom apartment or a 3-bedroom condo, it's 1 residential unit.
So your assumption when you were doing your back of the envelope was using it as a 1-bedroom apartment.
And the reason I did that was to get the greatest number, to give people who were concerned that we had 500, 600, 700 units, to give them an understanding that we wouldn't have that. As I stretched it as much as I could, made those units as small as I could, with the least amount of parking that was needed, to get that number as high as I could, I came up with 149.
On the other hand, there's the trade-off that if that's 2 or 3 bedroom apartments, then you're more likely to have children, and then you have other impacts.
And you'll have far fewer of them, because in the same building that you could get 30 1-bedroom apartments and accommodate the 30 cars that go along with them, you might get 10 2 or 3 bedroom condos and the 2 cars that go along with them.
And the 10 kids.
Right. So the numbers go way down.
Are there any comparables in other communities that we could hear from you about it, just so we can put this in some kind of context?
I wouldn't say there's anything comparable in another community. There's something comparable in our town. We have the University Avenue Multiple Use Overlay District, and that allows mixed-use development. In that case, it's limited to 1/3 of the floor area, not 50%, and it has a specific cap of 650 units. In the University Avenue Overlay District. So there's a case where we have a specific cap. We have the floor area cap as well as a numerical cap. Then we have other sections of our zoning bylaw, one that allows accessory apartments and another that allows conversions of single families to two family houses. Those have a cap in the form of a percentage. You probably remember last year and the year before last year, we increased the percentage of special permits that could be issued for accessory apartments from 1% of total housing units in town to 2%. So while that's not a finite number, it is, in that you only have so many units in your town at any one time, so a percentage of them gets to you, to that number. It's a number that increases as our development goes up, but it is a cap, so it serves the same purpose. So, and we do the same thing in conversion of single family to two family, that's limited to no more than 1% of the units in town, residential units. So we do this already in some other zoning districts, and this type of zoning we had not initially done. We just capped it with the percentage of floor area. And this would instill another cap, really for the sole purpose of giving people a limit to what they could expect, to help people better understand and be less fearful of the unknown that people have overinterpreted as a much greater number than I think we could ever see.
So if you have your public hearing next Tuesday, which I think is October 3rd, will you be finalizing this language that night with the Board of Selectmen and the Planning Board? What's your process? And again, not to be a broken record, but we've got our next meeting at which we have public hearing and we're expected to vote October 17th. So we're just trying to get as much as we can in advance of that.
Yes, I mean, generally the Planning Board opens a public hearing and then reports to you on their recommendation. If there's any changes, it's usually done in the first public hearing. We usually keep the hearing open until town meeting, but we intend to keep it open during your public hearing too, because that allows the zoning article to change even at your meeting if there's additional public. The hearing is open, but the Planning Board is prepared to make a recommendation for your public hearing.
Get that probably from you folks sometime next week after your meeting.
Yeah, we're meeting the 6th. Hold on, 6th. Might vote on the 6th if they get something to vote on. So the expectation would be that we would be voting on the Planning Board on the 6th.
Great. I'm just trying to get the timing of all this so we can get this
going. No, great questions.
Any other questions on the FMUOD article? I do not see any more.
I'm sorry, I'm going to be 2nd.
16th.
Next Tuesday is the 3rd.
No, the next meeting.
So it'll be the
16th.
16th.
The night before you.
Okay.
I don't.
That's why I'm asking. Well, you'll have your language.
Mm-hmm.
It will then go to the selectmen. But at least if we could have the benefit from you folks, the Planning Board, in advance, so our members would have time to look.
Marianne, I think from a Board of Selectmen standpoint, one of the reasons we thought it was good to co-sponsor is we're turning to the Planning Board to get the language of the article right. We're really in the spirit of the concept, and Planning Board. They're the experts in the zoning, so we're not going to be changing the language. We're on the concept.
Right.
So our job is to interface with them at their meeting, which I think we would like to do.
Thank you for that. That's helpful. Thank you. Okay, so should we now turn to Abby?
Yeah.
And,
so thank you. That's a technical overview. Obviously, we'll have much greater detail for next meeting.
That's great.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Any other questions for the selectmen?
No.
Oh, Pam.
Sorry, can you mention one other item
while
the selectmen are still here? Just,
please.
If we were talking about the Municipal Modernization Act, there was one other item that came out of that we will use this year, and that was there was an update to the snow and ice spending process. And again, trying to make that a little bit more efficient and a little bit more timely. So the selectmen discussed that at their meeting this summer and agreed to the new procedure that we're allowed to do, which is we set that snow and ice budget at town meeting. If there's a need to overspend that during the year, the approval process now is to go to the town administrator. So the DPW has to give their information and their request to the town administrator, who can approve that higher spending level. And then he would report that out and make sure to get that to the selectmen and to the finance commission. And so it's just to make it a little bit more timely. I think this year you might have voted one of the snow and ice in May or June, you know, so it's just the way it works. It really wasn't efficient. So they made that change. The selectmen discussed that this summer. And we did a little write-up of just what the new procedure will be. And so when I get that other special ed to Jane, maybe I can give you that snow and ice that you can send out to the members. But we wanted you to know kind of before the season started that it would just be working a little bit differently.
Thanks.
And
if we got a terrible winter, we'll plan.
I'm not expecting anything soon.
No stuff.
Okay, so thank you very much. Again, thank you, all of you. And we'll turn it over to the planning board for the rest of their proposals. Thank you.
Article J, that is the planning board article to allow accessory uses for cafeterias, snack bars, vending machines in the highway business zone. We currently have that accessory use listed in our accessory use table. It's only allowed in our industrial and ARO zones at this time. It was recently in August, we were approached by a property owner in the highway business zone, which is the area along Route 1, that he was looking to market his building that's becoming, being emptied. So we'd like to have the opportunity to have a cafeteria there. So I brought that to the planning board, and the planning board has submitted this request to change us in our accessory uses. We believe this was put in place many years ago. I've gone back at least 23 years, and it's only been allowed use in our industrial zones. We think probably to encourage employees in the around Route 1 and the local businesses on High Street, Washington Street to visit you know, other restaurants. However, times have changed. We've expanded in industrial zones where University Station is. There's many restaurants, but we allow this use, accessory use, in those areas. So if anyone would like to extend that opportunity to the highway business zone as well. So cafeterias are intended to be interior to the building and primarily serve the employees of that property.
Questions from FinCom?
The gift shops, I mean, that's still an internal.
Yes.
I mean, I can understand, like, some of the auto dealers have gift shops inside, you know. But, I mean, we're just going to allow gift shops, but they'll be only internal?
Yes, that's in the definition already. Yes, cafeterias, snack bars, gift shops, vending machines. Primarily for the convenience of employees and entirely within the building, no exterior advertising.
Is food sold in a cafeteria subject to the meal tax?
Yes.
Is food sold in a cafeteria subject to the meals tax?
Is food served to in a cafeteria, is that get the meals tax?
Well, my personal experience was, yeah, it's in the cafeteria at Stewart, which is over on Burwell. And I just remember that the cost of things was not around. So.
The only show combinations license for the internal but for the internal.
We did not. There's no CV license.
It's not. I don't think, I think it's exempt as an employee benefit. I don't believe it's taxed. It's a good question. I don't believe it is.
There's different ones. There are.
We might have just found a new revenue source.
Well, there are some that are CV that we allow.
If it's open to the public,
if it's open, yeah. The difference is whether it's an employee only or it's not an employee.
Not so much.
Well, that's a good question. We'll research it.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
think just the general, would there be any reason not to do it? Any concerns?
Well, the original purpose, I think, was to get employees out of their office buildings and to local businesses.
That would be
the one. But the benefit is that we want to also be competitive and have more encouraged commercial and office uses. So we want them to locate here. Maybe a cafeteria. We'd like to allow that.
The most important factor here is that's an empty building. The lease is running out. We want it occupied, and the owner thinks that this will attract businesses to locate there. If that's true, that's what we want.
The market apparently for these types of developments often sort of repurposing of former industrial uses in the center for office space is highly competitive at this moment in time. That's a very common amenity that developers need to offer to attract the right tenant.
Tom just came to mind. Mark mentioned about how car dealerships sometimes have gift shops. That central Chrysler dealership advertises a big cafeteria, a cheap grill or something. Is that something that they would not be allowed to do if Prime has three big buildings?
Right, they still would be, but they're in a highway business district, so those uses are permitted. They're allowed to have a fast food use, they're allowed to have a gift shop.
Externally, this is just internally they can't have.
Well, they still can have it if it's an entity within the building. It's a use that's permitted. It would be permitted as an accessory use, but for their food service, they are required to have a CD license because they are open to the public. And this is looking for something that would not have to have a CD license. It would just be an employee cafeteria.
Mercedes has a CD license.
They do, yes.
Any other questions on this one?
Article K is to amend our definitions. We're updating our definitions for medical center and clinics, as well as healthcare professional, to be consistent in our bylaw, and adding some new definitions for hospital. If you realize this higher intensity use hospitals and substance abuse facilities, we didn't have defined in our zoning. So we're adding those new definitions and updating our table of uses. Clarifying where and then
how
that.
Questions? Questions on that one?
Can I ask, what's the general impact though? Like, I'm not familiar enough. Like, I know there's issues at Westwood Lawn, but so by changing this, does this change the Brigham and Women's development and what they're able to service? Does it change what Westwood Lodge can service in that?
So I can ask for Brigham and Women's. That was developed under the University Avenue Multiple Use District that specifically allowed a medical clinic. The definition for medical clinic and office of a healthcare professional came from the University Avenue Multiple Use Overlay District. Those same phrases and definitions were not repeated elsewhere in the bylaw. They were different phrases, office of a doctor or dentist. That was the only one we had, that's right, elsewhere. So the other uses, either a clinic, like a substance abuse clinic, or a medical center or clinic or a hospital, they simply weren't mentioned. So the way our bylaw is written right now, if someone wanted to put a hospital somewhere, it would be a use not mentioned in the bylaw, and they would go to the Zoning Board of Appeals for, a finding to overturn the zoning enforcer's decision that a hospital wasn't allowed, and they would have to deal with that. If our zoning bylaw doesn't say it's allowed or not allowed, it's just not clear, and then the decision's made by the zoning board. So this makes it a clear process where it's only allowed only in the, for a hospital, for instance, is only allowed in the industrial, in the ARO zone, and only by special permit by the zoning board, but it's specifically disallowed in all other zones. Right now, without mentioning it, it would have the same ability to go in any zone, residential zone, an industrial zone, if the ZBA took up the matter and approved it. So this is more limited than what we have. It's intentionally steering these high traffic uses to the areas that we think can best accommodate.
Any other questions on that one? I think we can move on
Does that include like a minute clinic or something, you know, one of those?
It does. That would be a medical office or clinic, medical center or clinic. And so this is written to allow those by special permit in the industrial zones, industrial office, and ARO district. In addition to that, they're specifically permitted in the University Station area. And there are two of them, one in there now and one that's going into the Purdue Women's Building. And that's the board.
Any other questions on that one? Okay, we can move to the next one.
And the next one is L is a general housekeeping for in case we discover any errors or typos during the public hearing process. So we haven't discovered any yet, but that's where we're going.
Great, thank you. Any other questions from FinCom for Abby and the planning board before they finish up? Thank you very much. Dottie, I know you're here. Would you mind presenting to us? You did talk to us last time, but some of our members weren't with us. And so if you could just give us a preview, please, of your articles, that would be great. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you for your time this evening. And you will see that there was three, but one has been taken off. So the first one is to adopt Mass General Laws, Chapter 41, Section 110A. And what this consists of is if a voter registration session should fall on a Saturday, the deadline would go to the day before, the Friday, the business day. And if there were, it's for petitions, initiative petitions, that would go to the next business day for those type of petitions. So basically, the reason why I think this is a good idea is because usually we have late voter registration sessions and we don't have anybody that comes anymore. There's many means to register to vote now, to register to vote online, with the registry of motor vehicles. We send out new resident packets with voter registration cards. When our citizens turn 18, we send out voter registration cards. It also would save the town money to open up a building from 8:30 in the morning until 8 p.m. Now, if we knew that there was going to be perhaps, you know, an election with something, big items, and we were anticipating a high voter turnout, then of course we may decide, well, maybe we should have our voter registration kept to that Saturday. But it's at our discretion, so we're not bound by that. It's just it gives us the option to not have to open the office on a Saturday, or let's just say that it fell on a Sunday for petitions. It would just be during working hours.
Any questions for Dottie from now?
Yes. Previously, we had asked if people would still be able to register on Saturday through the state website.
No.
So that's going to be...
It's always 20 days before an election. And if it fell on a Saturday, the voter registration day, it would go to Friday. So we would have to adhere to that deadline.
And the state, so how would you coordinate that with the state?
Well, it's basically... Whatever the date that we had determined, it's still, you know, within the time. Basically, it's for any elections that we may have, any town elections, we may have a special election. So we can't really change a voter registration, and the state would not have a voter registration date on a Saturday or Sunday. So this is basically if we had an election, let's say we have a special election, or, you know, for some reason, what wouldn't happen with our annual town election. So if we had a special election, basically, and the date fell on a weekend, but the state would never have any cities or towns, they would never have the deadline following those dates.
So then basically all their information would be you have to register by that Friday, and that would be in conjunction with
our... Right, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
many towns have adopted that. The next one I have is it's accepting Master General Law Chapter 140, Section 139. And what this would do is waive the dog license fee for seniors. They would still, this is anybody age 70 or older, and it's only one dog, and if they have a kennel, they would not be exempt from this. So basically, it's something that I believe strongly in. It's a $10 fee. We have many senior citizens that have a difficult time, first of all, getting into town hall. It's not accessible. They don't have a computer so that they can register the dog online. So with this, they still have to register the dog. However, they're going to be exempt from a $10 fee. And I think that it may seem like a trivial amount to most of us, but $10, if you know, it may pay for somebody's medication. So if we as a town, you know, we care about our elderly people who have done a lot to get this town to where it is, I think it's something good for us to do. And I appreciate you all thinking about it. Do you have any questions?
Yeah. How much did we collect in license fees last year?
We collect about $20,000. So this would be 143 people approximately. So we're talking $1,400.
Thank you very much, Dottie.
You're welcome.
So I think at this point we can move on to the petitioner article.
My question is, the petitioner article is replacing her article, or is she just withdrawing the article?
I'm sorry, I'm just withdrawing the article.
You what?
I'm just withdrawing the article.
Okay. So we have four petitioner articles. First, we have on our list is, has been filed by Steve Barrett. It's Mr. Barrett here.
He's on here.
Are one of you presenting on his behalf? Do you know, or?
I don't have the presentation. We really just moved the articles yesterday. So basically, he submitted the article because a lot of people are confused about that particular article and what actually transpired. And he'd like to see, because there's so much confusion about it, he'd like to see basically just start from scratch and let's see if we can, you know, what we can work out from the very beginning. People were so confused about it. Keep using that word, but I apologize. I don't have some presentation.
Well, thank you. And actually, could you just please state your name?
Oh, sure. Sadie Conant, Stressor.
Thank you. And just to clarify for everyone, we're looking at petitioner article filed by Mr. Barrett, which is to see if the town will vote to rescind the vote on Article 29 at the annual town meeting on May 2nd, 2017. So I appreciate your sharing what you understand to be the impetus for this, and we will hope to hear from Mr. Barrett
at our public hearing
on October 17th. Did you have something?
I just think there's a typo there. I think it's 2016, not 2017.
Oh, I have what was, okay, we've got a few.
It is 2000.
Oh, you're right, his petition says that, and I misspoke because it had been summarized by that, so thank you for putting that out. Okay. All right, we'll have to move on then. So the second petitioner article is filed by Ms. Rollins. Which is to see, maybe I should read the original and not what was presented to me. Bear with me a moment, please, Ms. Rollins. Let me get this right on the record. Okay, to see if the town will vote to raise, appropriate, and transfer from any available funds in the Treasury the sum of $20,000 to purchase an electronic voting system for use at town meeting with 350 handheld
their action thereon?
Probably next.
Well, this and the other petition article are related. The other petition article would be to actually ask the town to adopt electronic voting, and then that one would be to appropriate the funds to pay for the equipment.
Okay. Let me just read that one for the record, if I may. Actually, would you please state your full name and address?
Absolutely. Ellen Larkin Rollins, 86 Greenville Road.
Great. I'll just read it for the record so it'll come out clearly. So the second article by Ms. Rollins, which accompanies the first one I just read, if you will, to see if the town will vote to amend Westwood Town Bylaw 138-17 by deleting sections F, G, and H in their entirety and replace with, quote, primary vote of town meeting shall be by electronic voting. If the number of voters exceeds the number of voting devices pursuant to Mass General Laws, Chapter 39, Section 10, the moderator shall designate an overflow room for vote by show of hands and shall appoint an assistant moderator pursuant to Mass General Laws, Chapter 39, Section 14, to preside at and regulate proceedings in overflow room or take any other action thereon. So with that, we'll turn the floor to you, Ms. Rollins.
Sure. It's a very wordy way of basically saying we've heard from many residents that they would like to see Westwood move to electronic voting rather than voice and standing votes, for a few reasons that we've heard is it's efficient, accurate, and it also affords residents a degree of privacy as to how they're voting on issues that they don't feel that they currently have. That's a top-level summary. I know other towns have moved toward Dover used it this year very successfully for their entire warrant. Webster uses it for their entire warrant. I'm calling other towns to see. I know a lot of people use it for some of their warrant, not all of it, but the folks that have used it for their entire warrant, in Dover in particular, they said they got through a very large, controversial warrant in one night, and they were very pleased with the ability to get votes tallied very quickly. Particularly, they had some really hot-button issues that were on the warrant this spring, and it's a huge attendance, and they got through it all. They were there until midnight, but they got it done. So so that's kind of the high level. We'll go into more and provide more details and statistics and whatnot at the formal presentation, but that was the impetus as to why we brought the article forward.
Questions?
How solid is the $20,000 number for 350?
That's based on a quote from Turning Systems. I think it sounds like it works out to be about $50 a unit. There's options to rent as well. I spoke to the town clerk in Falmouth because they've just gone through this process, and he said, you know, there's lots of options you can borrow from other towns. I think there's some, that article could be amended or adopted depending on if we decide we want to buy X amount, rent others, maybe borrow. But based on if we looked at the last 10 or 12 town meetings and what the average attendance was, and it was about 300 to 400 on average. So that's why we felt 350 was a safe number. But yeah, that number is a little more. I think that bakes in if we needed to rent some additional units on top of. We didn't want to say exactly this is what it would cost to buy the 350. We wanted to give an idea of if we bought 300 to 400 and then needed to appropriate some other ones some other way, there was some cash baked in there to do that.
Cindy and Jim,
my question.
Direct my question to Ms. Powers. You had proposed similar language and then withdrew it. Are you against it? Is it just not ready for it? What was your motivation for removing the article?
To be honest with you, it was something that it's a moderator's meeting, and it would have to be really discussed with the moderator.
And you're not opposed to the idea?
No.
Barb and then Chris?
Of those towns that you talked about, are all of those open town meetings or are they representative town meetings?
Dover's an open town meeting. Falmouth's representative, so they bought, when I spoke to him, he said they have 249 people. They know there'll be 249 reps, so they bought 250. But Dover's an open town meeting.
Webster?
It's representative? Webster's representative.
Okay. I know you've brought this up many times, Dottie, and I've been very vocal in that I particularly think that town officials, we should know how they vote. And I know there were some issues in Wayland, but they've seemed to satisfy themselves and they have decided to continue them until, I think, 2019. But I think something that is really going to change something in the town meeting, we need to have some sort of committee to take a look at it, to go out and look at, and not have it, you know, have a good study of it. So, I mean, I just, you know, I'm not totally against it. I have been in the past, but I'm not totally, but I think that to really look at the different ramifications, a lot of towns have looked at it and chosen not to go forward with it. Chris?
I was wondering about the actual logistics, and I guess we talked about the appropriation of 20,000 or what it would cover. If we have another issue like 10 years ago, 15 years ago, we had with Westwood Station, we had a town meeting in the gym. I don't know what the numbers were in attendance there, but I don't know if this type of money could handle renting that, and then what do we do if that were to surface?
You have options. You can borrow from other towns. Like if a town that owns their equipment wants to loan them to us, they probably wouldn't charge us for it. I also am going to talk to Turning more. From what I was told by the Falmouth town clerk, when you rent, it's a flat fee, and it's a flat fee for anywhere from 50 to 2,000, and they run the equipment for you. So the rental option isn't necessarily per unit. So there, that's. I'll present more detailed cost analysis of the bigger. But it's not necessarily a one-for-one, like, oh, if we have to rent 2,000, it's $50. It doesn't work that way, from what I've been told.
Yeah, my first thought, I'm happy to hear that, because when you said 350, that room holds, what, close to 500? 600? My thinking was, where do they go? And there's a feeling of disconnection there for those citizens who are pushed somewhere else because they happen not to get here in time. So I'm happy to hear that those are possibilities.
Yeah, again, that number was just based on looking at the last dozen or so town meetings and what the average attendance was. We just wanted to put a figure out there. But yeah, I know there were, for University Station, there was over 1,000 people at that meeting, and we don't want to create a disconnect. So we'd like to present all the options that would be inclusive for 2,000, if that's something that you're interested in, which it sounds like you are. So.
Sure. Right, I think Barbara suggested that you probably have to have some representative committee really looked into this. One of the concerns I have, obviously, is I'm not expecting the Russians to intervene, but security's a big issue. Indeed, this is a very, very basic type of system. And I've heard discussions, you know, should you allow people to be able to vote through their iPad or, and I think we ought to look at it, because the next question to me is, you know, for the elderly, why is the next extension you're going to allow people to vote remotely? So in other words, if you have a quorum show up, why should somebody, an elderly person, not be allowed to be online and vote remotely? So I think really it should be studied. And to me, security is a very, very big issue. These are not the most sophisticated systems, and we just need to make sure that, you know, you can go from completely open, where we get to see how everybody votes, to all of a sudden we don't get to see how anyone votes. And you're really going to change the dynamics what goes on at town meeting. And to me, one of the intriguing things about town meeting is the ultimate democracy in action. And you can't get any more pure than what goes on in town meeting and governance. And I just want to make sure that if we change the way we do it, we've thought it through. And I know in the Charter Commission, there was a lot of discussion about do we go to elected town representatives or do we stay with the open town meeting? And I think a lot of thought went into it. And I think we have to put as much thought into this and not just look at today, but okay, is this the first step that all of a sudden 5-10 years down the road, it'll all be remote with online access, or is this an initial step? I like Barbara's suggestion a lot. We really should thoroughly study this.
I do think it needs to come from the moderator. I read about their experience in Wayland, and they had a committee, it's called Elvis, that looked at it. And there was a lot of accusation of voter fraud the first time it was used, with people holding multiple units and all. And the issue is that the moderator said, well, I didn't hear any of that, and there's been a lot of controversy after that. Now, they did continue it, but, you know, there are some issues that need to be looked at. I think if we're going to need it, we want to have access to the maximum number, because those would be the contentious votes where there are going to be a lot of people out there. And do we use it for, I think the moderator needs to decide if we're using it for every vote or just the ones that, you know, would involve us standing up or, you know, that sort of thing. I think there's just a lot more involved in it.
Am I allowed to respond or is...
Please.
I just wanted to respond to some of your concerns, which I absolutely understand where you're coming from. I'm not personally advocating for remote voting. As far as security goes, I'm not convinced that a standing vote with people walking from row to row counting is the most accurate or the most secure, whatever word you want to use, way to determine the numbers. It's certainly not the most efficient, and you know, I have my own concerns about the way we do it now. And the visibility thing, I do understand what you're saying, but I agree with your point. Town meeting is the ultimate democracy in action. I've heard many people say that they don't feel like they can vote honestly because everybody is watching them. And I think town meeting should be the ultimate democracy in action, and people shouldn't feel uncomfortable. I personally believe that anonymity will make for a more honest town meeting. That's just my personal feeling, and I've heard that echoed by many residents who have said they weren't comfortable voting with the minority because they feel like they're being judged.
The counterpoint to that is we made the decision on the Charter Commission to stay with open town meeting versus going to elected representative. And to me, you know, that's a very important decision. Therefore, I think we need to think this thing through. The other thing is, even if you look at the legislature, there's electronic voting, but it's listed who you voted for.
Even when they have representatives at a meeting, they show who.
So my point is, to me, the biggest issue is if we're going, if you want to, the real issue is, you know, if I mean, think of the implications. 400 people show up, and we know what happens at 11 o'clock at night. You know, certain people are tired and they leave. If it's all electronic, does that mean that determines whether or not there's a quorum? I mean, there's just so many ramifications from it, but I don't know. And to me, if we made the decision as a town to stay with open town meeting, not to go to elected representative town meeting, so I think this needs a very different, I mean, respecting your opinions, we really need to talk these issues through and not just do something and all of a sudden say, well, we never understood the implications.
And just, can I add another point? Because we talked at the end of June and then in September about people voting, understanding what is meant by indefinite postponement. And I think when you're, from a user perspective, you could have, without the right level of information and clarity around what, you know, a green button versus red button or whatever it is, I think when you have to make that decision quick, you do, can have some user error. Whereas if you're standing up, you do have a little bit more time to process how you're voting and sit down or stand back up. So,
or your neighbor might know what
right,
you're intending
right,
to vote.
Right, so I think I agree with you, Bob. I think some of the broader implications, obviously it's progressive and we should maybe get with the times, but just to understand what it means from all perspectives.
Yes.
Is your primary motivation for this to add anonymity? To the process? Is that the primary motive?
I think that the efficiency, accuracy, and people feeling comfortable to vote the way that they actually want to vote, that's all, they're all equally important to us.
Do you have any evidence that the current process is not, I mean, it's not anonymous, but it's not accurate?
No hard evidence. I don't think it's particularly efficient, having been at the last town meeting. I think if we had had, there were some long presentations, long conversations, but I think if we'd had a more efficient system than standing votes, we wouldn't have had to go to two nights necessarily. We probably would have been able to finish the warrant in one night.
Actually, Whalen made the comment when they first went into it, don't go into this thinking you're going to make it more efficient because the process still goes a long time. It was really the anonymity. They've had some very bitter votes on schools and all, and it was the anonymity that it didn't save them any time. And one of the towns, I think that, I'm not sure if they did adopt it, they have 3-day town meetings. I think it's Duxbury.
Well, it was successful in Dover in spring. It definitely, I talked to people who were there and they said it was a longer warrant with more people than previous years and they got through it in one night. They moved it along. So it probably varies from town to town. So it's possible.
Any other questions on this article? Thank you very much, Ms. Rollins. We look forward to seeing you on October 17th. We've scheduled that meeting for an additional second night if needed, just to let you know that. But we look forward to seeing you then. And our last and final article for this evening is Ms. Conan's. And Ms. Conan, if I may, I think what I'm going to do is just read for the record and for the members the relevant so that we can put your article in context, if that's okay with you. Actually, would you please identify yourself again?
Sure, Debbie Conan, Strasser Ash.
Thank you very much. So Ms. Conan's article, petitioner article, seeks to amend bylaw section 138-15, motions in order of business. I'm just going to read to you so we all have this in our mind, what it is that she is seeking to amend, which is, again, 138-15D1, which says motions at town meeting under the article, negative and affirmative motions. Number one says the recommendation of the Finance and Warrant Commission shall be the first motion under an article of the warrant and shall be considered the main motion. So again, this is in the context of town meeting. And now I'll just read what I have in front of me. Let me read the original language. Thank you. Which says, to see if the town will vote to amend Westwood Town Bylaw 138-15D1 by inserting the following language after the wording, considered the main motion. Okay, and this is the language that you are proposing. Excluding citizen petitions, period. The sponsor of a citizen petition shall make the first motion, and said motion shall be considered the main motion of that article, or take any other action thereon. So with that, Ms. Conan, why don't you tell us what it is you're seeking to do here and why, please.
What we're trying to do is to get rid of indefinite postponement, because that citizen's petition seem to be the only petitions that have that attached to it. And it's just a procedural barrier to allow people to discuss an article. And we didn't want to take the complete authority away from the advisory board by saying you can't say indefinite postponement, but we'd like to say with citizens' petitions, we'd like to make the first motion, and then you obviously could have your say after. And you could still say indefinite postponement, but we want the right to be able to discuss it. And last meeting, people were very upset and confused. Even no matter how many times we told them, the moderator explained it to them, we left there. People thought they still won. And it was a real sad situation. So if we could just get rid of the language for them and just vote on the article for citizens' petition. We don't really see it with the financial or with the town petition, just with ours, or not ours per se, but citizens' petitions, it would make for a more efficient process in voting. And people won't feel like they're being, it's more transparent, if you may.
I feel compelled to say that if this body does vote indefinite postponement on any number of articles, often we don't even have petitioner articles. And if you look back, even in this warrant book, I'm not certain on that, but we certainly have in the past voted indefinite postponement on selectmen articles, planning board articles, many times. So if you go back, you will see that. But I understand your point, and we certainly don't want people to be confused about what's happening at town meeting. Anybody wants, but I'll open it up to questions.
I mean, it addresses a concern we had about the terminology of indefinite postponement. I'm not sure, but there are articles that are sponsored by boards that we have voted indefinite postponement, and I'm not sure it's really fair to just segregate out the citizen petitions.
If I may, so but if you go back in the last 10 years, all the citizens' petitions, except for the past two, we were able to indefinitely postpone it, or citizens' petitions that were indefinitely postponed.
So has town, I know that you just submitted them today or yesterday, so has town council looked at that, or, you know, because that was a lot of the discussion we had about how we're
procedural.
How, yeah, how we can proceed. Or is it moderator decision?
Well, this is addressed in the bylaws.
Yeah.
So it's a bylaw issue, and that's how she's framed the issue. So I don't, I think she's, I'm not
doing
town council, but I
yeah.
think this is the way to do it, is to change it by bylaw. But we only saw this afternoon
right.
for the first time, so
right.
I don't
I apologize,
know if,
we were late getting today.
And you've got it in by the deadline. We just got it, so no apologies needed. I don't even know if town council has seen this yet. We haven't gotten that far in the process.
He has not.
He has not.
Well, he's seen it, but he has not done any in-depth analysis.
Okay.
Which I'm
we
sure
did,
will be forthcoming.
We did pass a sign attorney.
Okay.
Who is familiar with town meeting times and the bylaws, so
okay.
it was not the town council, but it was not the
Do you know if there's a similar procedure to the one you're proposing used in another town?
I'm not sure. I do know that another moderator that I spoke to, that they don't really use indefinite postponement a lot. So because either you're for it or against it, and if you're not for it, then just, you know, explain it and still give us the right to debate it and vote on it. And as I said, it's a procedural barrier to allowing us to vote on something that we feel is important. So
I think I'll just point out, if I may, just a point of order that section 138-15-2, I just want to read this portion of the bylaw, which says a motion for indefinite postponement shall be equivalent to a motion that no action be taken under the article and such motion may not be amended. So I just wanted you folks to have that in mind. Howard.
So I'm not sure I really understand this. Does this mean that a citizen motion is presented to the town without a recommendation from the planning committee?
I think
that's what it sounds like.
I think what you're proposing is something different.
This would be first. So,
so
this would present to the town.
It would allow
the finance committee wouldn't be saying a word about it.
No, it sounds like we have an advisory. We
yeah.
have an advisory recommendation.
But
that
it
she.
Be
they
would be different than we really do with that.
We make the motion.
We make the first motion.
The motion is for indefinite postponement, and they have.
But our recommendation would be for indefinite postponement.
Right. So they, we
it would be
vote.
Their motion. So it's equivalent to the same
no,
thing.
No, our no. We make
we
the
vote.
First
Sorry,
motion.
No.
Howard, we make the first motion, so whatever our, that's the first motion on the floor. So that needs to be overturned before there can be any discussion. So what they are proposing is that we can say what we, how we would vote in an advisory way, but the first motion on the floor would be made by the petitioner.
It wouldn't
and
have
our
to.
Recommendation, if our recommendation was for indefinite postponement for the second one, we would say that our recommendation for the first one was indefinite. So it really doesn't change anything other than make the motion.
That's right, it's possible.
Well, but the vote would still be for the article itself. It wouldn't be for indefinite postponement.
Because the motion would be
to debate the underlying article.
That debate just helps to erase that misunderstanding on how to vote. Even as I said, even though we explained it, it was people still didn't know what they voted for.
I just think that it just seems like you're presuming there's a bias against citizen petitions here. You're singling these specific petitions out and saying we should treat them differently. So you're assuming that our duties here are somehow biased in terms of.
No, I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that we didn't.
Then why did you like hold out one section of just petitions from citizens instead of everything else we do?
Right. It just seems like when you have a citizen come forward, when we have doctors, engineers, nurses. You know, all sorts of people who come together and want to, for example, our petitions last spring. There was a lot of thought that went into them, and it was indefinitely postponed when we felt there could have been an easy yes or no. You could have just said, vote no on this, and people look to you for advice. They value your advice, and they follow it. So automatically, they just voted the way they want the FinCon felt they should go without really having an opportunity to hear exactly what was going on and what the article was about, if you may.
So maybe without doing this, you would want some ability within the bylaw that says, even though we have indefinite postponement, you want to be able to make the presentation about the underlying article so that everybody could hear it, and then they could still vote indefinite postponement. Maybe that's,
I think the bottom
that's
line
more
is,
procedural.
Yes, is it, I don't understand why it can't be a yes or no vote. Why does it have to be, and it's backwards, you vote yes to postpone, but no.
If the motion's on the FinCom's recommendation.
Yeah, yeah. So yes. It's like the opposite of what you voted for.
Right.
And trust me, we educated and educated and educated. And yes, maybe people should go to more town meetings. But unfortunately, they don't. We never did until recently. And it's been a learning process, but it's still a complicated one. And we're just trying to make it so that people feel that their opinions and votes have value, and that they understand completely and fully what they're voting for.
I want you to know that we've talked about this since the spring, because you know we're concerned. We want to make sure people understand what's happening, what they're voting for, and you know, frankly, we even had some discomfort about what can we do by way of our votes. I think it comes down to the bylaws that provide what our options are, which is indefinite postponement or a recommendation in favor, as imperfect as those choices may be.
Which is why I wrote the article as it was.
Pardon me?
Which is why I wrote the article the way it was, so that would be inserted into the bylaw and still encompass. I mean, that's what we follow.
Any other questions on this article?
I'll ask a question. It may be that we need to defer this to town council, but since you mentioned you brought it up with the council already, legal council already, the way our bylaws read, or as Marianne mentioned, and then they sort of say there's a catch-all at the end that says, to the extent that the moderator has any questions come up that haven't been addressed in the bylaw already, they're to refer to this book called Town Meeting Time, which was written in 1964, and it's sort of a rules of parliamentary procedures that a lot of town meetings follow. And this, we've codified it by being in our bylaw. So I have two fundamental questions that I'm not sure any of us will be able to answer, but it is something that you may have asked your council, or maybe our town council can answer. One is, do we have any options other than this? In other words, does town meeting time mandate that on all petitions, whether they're municipal or citizen, that we have to make the first motion? Because that's what we always understand, that's what we operate. That's
sort of, ask that question.
And then whether it's in town meeting time or not, even more importantly, is it in the mass state laws governing town meetings, open town meetings? And if it's not, then we can move forward and have this discussion. If those things are mandated by mass law, then we can't. So we really need to ask council if this conversation is even something that we can do, or if it's moved.
It's definitely, I mean, definitely speak to him, but I did ask those questions, and they said that whatever's put in the bylaw is what we go by. So if this were to be accepted and put in the bylaw, then this would be suffice in terms of town meeting time. Regardless of what town meeting time says, even though we follow that, it's what's in the bylaw. If that makes sense.
It does. I think we just need to make sure we understand that.
George?
You know, one thing I would add, I think a very valid point has been raised, it's confusing. And so I think we have an obligation. If there is no alternative, how do we at least provide some clarification for people to show up? I don't know the answer. But I think, you know, they raise a valid point. It's confusing. I mean, I have to stop and think which way we're going, and we live with this all the time. So at the end of the day, if we can't correct it because of legal requirements, is there a way that we can somehow clarify it? And I know when the, you know, moderator gets up there, that's not the time to clarify it, because that's very hard for people to understand. I don't know the answer, but maybe we've just got to figure out a simplistic way of explaining why we have to make the first motion. And that if people want to get to the underlying issue, what's the process they have to go through? Because I think that's your concern, that they couldn't get to the underlying issue without going through this process of dealing with our first, that we have to make it. it was confusing. So I'm just wondering, is there a way to recognize a very legitimate issue? I'm not sure what the answer is. So I think Mike suggested, let's find out what we can do legally, and if we can't change it legally, how do we, is there a way to clarify it to people?
I think there's some wiggle room as far as the moderator allowing some overviews of the articles. You know, we do it all the time when we have a bunch of articles without debating the question itself, at least doing some sort of overall presentation.
Sorry, one last thought. But going back to George's earlier comment about the fact that we have a charter committee, and I'm not sure they ever got to this question, but you can imagine a few times planning board or historical commission where we voted indefinite postponement a couple years ago on, and some things that the selectmen want. These folks might say the same thing. We said, listen, we like her idea, and we would rather the FinCom's opinions be advisory generally. Whoever makes the petition is the person who makes the motion. That the question there is that seems a little more constitutional.
And Mike, I'm not going there at all.
I'm saying
I think you've got to maintain the integrity of what the FinCom is supposed to do, which is to make the initial motion. But the process, if somebody wants to get to the underlying issue, how do they get to it in a way that they understand? That's all I'm saying. Because I think that's our job is to make, no matter what that's part of the heavy responsibility why we put the hours we put in, because we have to make that
Well, no one suggests. I don't think she's suggesting we don't make a recommendation. I think the question is, who gets to make the first motion?
Yeah.
And to Rob's point, the question is, are we making the first motion on 80%, but not the last 20, or are we making them? And that can be even more complicated to say, we're not really making the motion on this one, but we did the last 7.
Well, I think it's almost got to be universal, because you start changing, you'll never know what's going on.
Yeah. Now, the other thing, too, just to kick it around, is that, you know, the sponsor, you folks last year or you folks this year, it's... There's always debate on the substantive question, regardless of what our motion is. And you're certainly entitled to take the microphone and say, here's what I think substantively, but also procedurally, we need you to vote. If you're with me on this, vote against the definite postponement, and then we'll come back and propose. So you can explain the process as part of your dialogue. There's no limitation to your ability to talk substantively, regardless of what we recommend.
Yeah, that's a reconsideration.
Right, but it's
a
counter-argument. I don't understand why you guys can't just say yes or no.
Well, we've talked, this is an interpretation, I'm not sure it's everybody's, but we can say yes, which means we recommend, when we say yes, we mean we recommend that you enact it at this town meeting. When we say indefinite postponement, it might mean you have to read the write-up to understand what the general philosophy of the 15 of us was. But it might mean we're against it, it might mean we don't have enough information, it might mean not right now, but maybe sometime down the road. So from what we say this, it means we're recommending that you don't put it in place at this meeting. And it could be for any number of reasons. And if you want to understand which of those reasons we're recommending that you don't adopt it for, you have to read the write-up. And that's a lot to ask people, and a lot of people don't know that that's the process, but that is what we've been doing for over 100 years.
Any other questions? We really appreciate you both being here tonight, which I understand was on short notice to you. So thank you, and hope to see you both back on October 17th for a public hearing. Thank you for being engaged in the process with us, public and press. Any other comments? With that, folks, so our next meeting, October 17th, we have the notice for a meeting on the 18th if we need it. The original schedule is to have our public hearing and to vote on the 17th, but we've reserved the 18th if needed. And then we will have a town meeting on November 7th, I think. 13th, thank you. Then we'll have our December meeting. I'll be sending out the committee, subcommittee assignment list probably later this week with Jane's help. Anything else anyone wants to raise? Oh, yes, thank you, Jane. We just need to assign the rest of the articles for write-ups now. Thank you, Jane. There's some good news on this, which is that...
You're going to do it all?
Ha, no. By my count, thank you very much, everyone. By my count, there are 19 articles. We've already assigned 4 at our last meeting.
already selected four for Jane and I to do, so that leaves, I think, 11. And so 15 minus 4 is 11. Perfect. So we just need everybody to take one, if you would, please. So I'm going to start with the list I have in front of me, the Blue Hills.
I'll take it.
Who said that?
Tom.
Great. Thanks, Tom. Gay Street Sidewalk Design Funding.
I'll do that.
Rob, thank you. I thought Jane and I would take the ARC grant of easement, we'll take the street acceptance, we'll take Hedgerow Lane, which then brings us, George, to the interim office space.
I'll take those
and the municipal,
too, yeah.
Thank you, George. Thank you very much, the municipal facilities. That brings us to the account for the meals / hotel tax.
Take those two.
Oh, I was going to.
Do you want those?
Yeah, I'd offer to take the school, so I think I'd.
Oh, take those two, Barb? Okay, Barb, thank you, Barb. That's meals, hotel, and the special ed reserve account. That's great. Julie's got the highway business. Mike P. has the medical definition, accessory uses. We'll do the zoning articles, housekeeping, Jane.
Yep.
That brings us to FMUOD 6 and 7, zoning amendment.
I'll do that.
Who said that? Chris?
Chris.
Great. Thank you, Chris. That's great. Okay, Cindy has the Chapter 41, Dottie's article, Section 110A. Peter's doing the dog license. That brings us to the petitioner article. So the first one is the article of Mr. Barrett regarding the town Article 29 vote. I'm not sure which year.
Wasn't the one last year about the change in the non-conforming, or is he just wanting to hear the whole thing?
I don't know. It's to rescind the vote. Any takers on that one? Okay, and that brings us to, we have Ms. Rollins' petitions, which I think would best be done as a couple.
I can do both of those.
Who said that?
Jim?
Thanks, Jim. And that leaves us with Ms. Conan's petition article regarding bylaw 138.15D. Cindy?
Yeah, but somehow I'll need your help.
I'll work with you on it. Thank you, Cindy.
And town council's going to look at all of these, I assume?
Yes, town council will look at all of these. We'll make sure we get his input for our next meeting.
On the one to rescind, wasn't there, what's the procedural process where vote that it can't be revisited? Do you know what I mean by that?
The motion for reconsideration.
Yes.
I think that only applies during the town meeting.
Okay.
But you folks are right that it says May 2nd, 2016 meeting. Do we even know that there was an Article 29 during that meeting? Or was it meant to?
Yes, that was the zoning amendment to add the footnote for the project area in the FMUOD.
Oh.
Oh.
So it does apply to that?
2 years ago.
I didn't understand. Okay.
Oh, okay. So this is not a non-conforming decision.
Right.
Okay.
This is a footnote.
Okay. Okay. So it's another version of last year's town meeting. It's taking the footnote away.
This is the article that was proposed and approved to settle a lawsuit with UNIAC.
We'll have that circulated, Jane. Yeah. We'll circulate that so we all have it handy. From the 2016.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so all of our articles have been signed.
So I have a question. If that was the one, is there any? Your question was if they bring it up again. So it's like another reworked version of what they had as far as taking away that footnote. And I thought once it's done, like there was some period of time where it couldn't be revisited.
Especially for
something like 2 years or something, isn't there?
Is there a period of time?
You cannot re-present an article that was defeated within 2 years without the specific sponsorship of the planning board.
And Nora, where is that? Is that in our bylaws? Is that in our charter?
I believe it's in our zoning bylaw, and I believe it also comes from the state meeting.
Okay.
So the question would then be whether article to rescind is equivalent to the state.
So town council will look at that.
Okay, we'll need that advice soon. Okay, anything else, folks? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn. We all adjourned. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thanks, everybody.